This episode is brought to you by Savio House. The holidays are so much more than the hustle and bustle of finding the greatest presents. It's about finding the magic in the little moments of spending time with family. Across Denver, kids are at risk of being separated from the only home they know due to life's toughest obstacles: addiction, violence, legal trouble. Savio steps in when crisis happens to get families back on track and make sure young people grow up with a loving family. Donate today at saviohouse.org/citycast. That's SAVIO house.org/citycast. Today on CityCast Denver. With a huge pro-Israel conference kicking off in Denver last night, Palestinian solidarity activists are planning protests all weekend downtown. But we got a preview on Monday night when protesters disrupted Denver City Council. We're talking to the Denver Post reporter who was in the room. Plus, Mayor Johnston's plan to revitalize downtown and our wins and fails of the week. Today is Friday, December 1st. I'm Bree Davies, and here's what Denver's talking about. Welcome back to CityCast Denver, the show about the city whose mayor's car recently got stolen. But I think what shocked us all was that the photo he shared on social media is what we assume is his car.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like an orange and blue painted Explorer or a Bronco. Did you see this, Joe?
It's the Escape. And my understanding is that car was previously stolen and it was actually the family's other car. They haven't provided more details, but there's this other family car got stolen this time. But the Escape was stolen in 17, and he shared that story on the campaign trail.
Oh.
A lot of commiseration in a city with such a high rate of car theft.
Is he driving? So he wasn't driving around in the Broncos color Jeep? Because photo was like, he has a different relationship to this team than I thought he did.
I've never seen that car in the wild, but yeah, I mean, he is a Broncos fanatic, and he's a Colorado guy.
It's a pretty easy way to show it, though, yeah. To be honest with you.
Truly. God, he tweeted that, like, do you all know the thing that, like, God must be a Broncos fan, because otherwise, why are sunsets blue and orange?
Yeah.
My in-laws have been, like, telling me this weekly, every year, for the whole time I've lived here.
And it's a religion.
Like, yeah, I just, oh boy.
You know,
it's great. I love it.
I have my friend Mo Graham just had a piece. She had a piece in Power Field. They did a bunch of commissioned pieces, but they gave each of the artists their own jerseys with their names on them.
Oh, that's cool.
And they gave them to him in a ceremony in the end zone.
Whoa.
She was like, fun. It was the coolest experience of my life. So shout out to the Denver Broncos, whoever's doing that stuff.
Oh my God, the Broncos are riding high right now.
You can feel it.
The whole city is like, I'm going to wear the flag.
Now, oh, yeah.
Or I'm going to put
it. Now you finally see it at the grocery store again on Sundays, Joe. Remember? It would be like everybody's emptier. Wearing Broncos gear if they're working, and then no one else is in the store.
Somebody texted me. I was like, everyone at King Super is going to be so nice today after the Broncos won.
Russell Wilson was at the Nuggets game last night.
Oh, was
he? Big pop from the crowd. Huge.
Oh.
People were like, Russ is here. Yeah.
It's probably good for him on the PR front that they're doing better when you want to go somewhere so public.
Yeah. You don't want to go to Blackhawk and drink alone at the casino.
No, you want to go to a ninth sold out Nuggets game of the year, I heard. So anyway, it's Friday. We're in the 5280 Magazine studios in beautiful downtown Denver. Of course, Paul Caroli, executive producer, is here. Hi, Paul.
Thank you. Hello. Yes. Good morning.
Joining us for strangely the first time. Known Joe forever. Joe Rubino covers City Hall for the Denver Post, among many other things you've covered in your many years here in Denver. Joe, welcome.
Well, thank you. Very happy to be here. And yeah, it is weird.
It is. Kennedy High School graduate. I know so much about you.
Yes, indeed. Denver born and raised, all that good stuff.
We're so glad you're here. So before we get started, we have two pieces of business. Paul, you heard back from the regional manager of Quick Trip about the opening date of the new location of the Monaco and Evans?
Yes.
Is it where Milo's Sports Tavern used to be?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yes. They knocked it down.
And built a gas station.
And they have
station.
Built not just any gas station.
A quick trip.
Yeah. I know everyone who heard the episode I did with Steve Stager and our friend Joshua Emerson a couple weeks ago probably wanted an update. I finally did hear back from this regional manager for Quick Trip, and he says the opening date, tentatively, is February 1st. So the gas price wars are coming to Virginia Village.
I think my real beef with this is I think Quick Trip just knocks down dive bars and builds new Quick Trips because they just someone knocked down Hart's Corner on by Tamale Kitchen.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're building a Quick Trip.
Is the Quick Trip going there too?
I'm pretty sure because it's a brand new gas station. I'm pretty sure it's a Quick Trip. I'll double check. But
they're coming in strong into this market.
They are. So
I can't wait to try it. I'm sure I'm going to love it.
Having recently visited Virginia Village, my aunt lives there and we did Thanksgiving. There's already that Murphy's and their prices are low. Mm-hmm. It is a gas station corner.
Oh, lots of gas stations.
Is it Murphy's? Yeah. Maverick? Maybe I'm mixing up the brand.
A Maverick,
I believe.
Maverick.
But it's a little further down.
There's a Stinker. Which is, that's fun.
Milo's talk about part of the Broncos religion. They used to do free Jello shots after a touchdown.
Really?
So rip Milo's.
I never went in there. It looked too scary by the time I moved to the neighborhood.
It wasn't quite Dirty Duck, but it was Milo's.
I had to pull an old roommate out of there that was wasted and was just face down in a plate of enchiladas. I was like, homegirl, we got to go home. It was a place. Yeah. So, yes.
Not R.I.P. quite Dirty Duck is saying something. Mm.
Yeah, I know.
I was like,
and Dirty Duck is... questionable. Still around, going strong.
Some true dive bars.
So, and then one more piece of important information is we need you. We need folks to sign up for the CityCast Denver membership. We're pitching it as a holiday gift, Paul. I like this.
Yeah, why not? It would be a great gift.
It's a way to give to your loved one and get them involved in local news, which is what we do. And you can support us right now by going to membership.citycast.fm. Sign up. You get some benefits we'll share. But really, the special thing to us is you're helping us make this show every day. We make this show 5 days a week. And we love to do it. And we really need you to help us keep going. And you have been so far. We've had...
So many people who have joined already. It's been a great showing of support, and we really do appreciate each and every one person. And it's the best way to keep the show going strong. So if you care about your city, if you care about us, you want us, every day with a newsletter and a podcast in your inbox and your feed. If you think that's value to you, sign up today for a membership or get one for a loved one and have something to talk about in the new year.
Yeah, we love that. So membership.citycast.fm. All right, top story. Paul, we're going to do something we haven't done much of today, which is we're going to talk about Gaza, but specifically what is happening here in Denver leading up to this week with tensions coming to a head around the Israel conference happening this coming weekend. Really quick, Paul, could you catch us up?
Yes, and I will go quickly because what happened on Monday night, Joe, you were there at City Council. We really want to hear what that was like, but in case somehow you have not heard or seen any of this news, the local stuff, I think, some highlights. Since the Hamas surprise attack on October 7th led to this Israeli assault, we've seen state representative and regular CityCast Denver guest Tim Hernandez go crazy viral on conservative social media when he maybe refused to condemn Hamas at a Palestinian solidarity protest. There have been calls for him to resign from the legislature. I hope we get to hear more of his story soon. There have been weekly protests, both Palestinian solidarity, Israeli solidarity. In Aurora, there was this divide within the Democrats and the far left. Mayoral candidate Juan Marcano resigned from the Democratic Socialists of America after some statements from different branches around the country. That was very surprising to me. And then last week during the special session on property taxes at the state legislature, Representative Elizabeth Epps was at the center of this very tense and emotional scene. She was pushing some legislation to promote boycotts of Israeli products and, she faced some resistance. Mm-hmm. It was very, very emotional, from what I can tell. Democrats, liberal cities like Denver are divided, and that kind of leads us up to Monday night, where, oddly across the world, there's the ceasefire that's holding for now, but in Denver, it seems to me, tension has never been higher.
And Joe, that's why we wanted to talk to you, because you were there on the ground reporting. Can you tell us what happened at City Council on Monday?
Well, it's been interesting, even before October 7th, this conference was coming, and it had been out there. And
this Jewish National Fund conference,
the JNF conference, coming to Denver. And one of the great things about public comment for me as a reporter is it's most of the time the people speaking there are speaking to something that's, happening on the city council agenda a lot of times. But sometimes they're coming to use that platform to speak about something else. And I you know, dating back to August, there were speakers coming from the Colorado-Palestine Coalition to speak out against this JNF conference and really urge the council.
That was before October 7th.
I mean, so like, you know, that obviously really heightened that. But, you know, there were people from the Colorado-Palestine Coalition coming and saying, you know, this is an organization that raises money for settler colonialism and covers up, you know, the brutalization of Palestinians. Like, you know, it perked my ears then, right? And then October 7th happens. I think the council members knew, I mean, 80 people signed up for public comment. It's a 30-minute session. Like, it was very much telegraphed this was going to happen. You know, it's not the first time that people to prove a point have refused to cede the floor. It's actually happened like 3 times now in the last 2 years.
Where they refuse to come off the podium.
When the time is up.
Give it back to council.
And you know, Council President Torres had a brief back and forth with Shannon Hoffman, who was kind of leading the group of, former council.
District 10 candidate,
And involved with Denver DSA, you know, involved in a lot of progressive causes in town. And she, once council decided to adjourn, you know, there was a brief back and forth. Councilwoman Torres, Council President Torres and Shannon, you know, Torres is like, you know, we're not doing this tonight, Shannon. Like, you know how this works. And, you know, to their credit, they also let somebody who is pro-Israeli speak. And it did get a little tense. I tried to speak to that man as he was leaving the room with some sheriff's deputies at his side. And he didn't want to give me his name. It was a little tense. He was standing up there with an Israeli flag, and some of the other pro-Palestinian speakers were standing there with their scarves, basically standing in front of him. So there was like some natural debate. He kind of went beyond his 3 minutes, and that's when it started to get more tense. And, you know, as he's leaving, they kind of shouted at him some things like go in shame, things like that. So it's interesting because so much of council's business is very practical. It's what's happening in the city now, right? It's how you carry out.
Yeah, we were kind of talking earlier. It's like trash collection or contracts for janitors and city buildings and things that make the city kind of go every day.
Yeah. And the council had very limited power. They don't oversee who's booking the convention center.
What power do they have, though? Because I don't think it's just about the conference. I think there's some specific policies. Because I was wondering about why this arena for the protest. Like, what are the real changes they're calling for?
Other cities have passed resolutions calling for a permanent ceasefire. Oakland, California, or was it Richmond, California? There's been some other cities. Detroit, I believe. And some of the protesters, some of the speakers on Monday night invoke those, like you could join these other cities and pass a progressive, you know, something that calls for a permanent ceasefire. And that is within council's power. I don't know if that's actually on their radar or not. You know, there's always this question of when it gets to this point, like, is the message reaching council members or not? You know, they left the room.
So all council left the room.
All council left the room, which, you know, in the past, sometimes some council members have stayed behind, but in the past, those, instances where people have kind of occupied the chamber have been very much focused on current city policies, specifically
Denver
around
issues.
Homelessness.
Yeah. So back to what's happening at the convention center, Paul, you're asking like, okay, is there anything in council's power? Joe, you're saying there's like a ceasefire resolution. They could sort of make a statement as a city. But other than that, I mean, when I think about convention center and city council, they're approving contracts for like, again, janitorial services or extensions or construction.
Mm-hmm.
Would they have any power over this? Or are any
booking at the convention center? Gosh, I should have quadruple checked this. I believe that is contracted to Visit Denver, which is our marketing.
Which is like
Visit Denver does
tourism.
And then there's a manager for the convention center itself that does like setting up and managing of events. So, I mean, they have an entity that they entrust with and task with booking business, bringing business to the convention center.
Which would be a convention like this. It's also the RV show or the, you know what I mean? It's all kinds of things.
But volleyball tournaments, you know, throughout the year, there's all kinds of stuff in there.
But there is I saw Bernie Sanders there. So it's like there's a political things happen. This is not uncommon.
Yeah, it's not like they shy away and it's only apolitical, certainly. So in terms of like what I have no idea what the appetite is amongst council members for anything like that.
But it is a statement of values. I think that's what the protesters would say is like, this is an opportunity for you to stand with us. And that's what they would want. So I don't know. I mean, whether or not they want that is kind of an interesting thing to me. And like, is that actually going to factor into the politics like of our next elections? Like, are these decisions that they're making now going to sway any Denverites votes?
And these are a lot of new council members who've been in their seats for less than 6 months, you know, so they're still trying to chart their course and say who they are to their constituents through the choices that they make. So
boy, is this a big choice.
It really is.
I mean, the where you stand on this issue, I don't have to say it. You kind of know it. I mean, after almost 2 months of this most recent war, this most deadly war, I think people are all pretty sure where they stand.
It's a precarious place to be too as a politician. I think as we've even seen by politicians here in Colorado who have spoken out and the repercussions of that, I understand. Even if we know where everybody, we think everybody stands, you're still making a stance that, I don't know. It's very complicated.
It's fraught, and it's where can you make an impact? And
yes.
I think for me, what sticks out is these pro-Palestinian voices aren't feeling like they're getting any traction at the national level. You know, they're protesting outside Joe Biden's hotel as well. And then at the state level, I mean, the governor is speaking tonight. It's Thursday. This will run on Friday. But the governor is speaking tonight at that conference. And we will have a reporter in the room, John Aguilar. We've covered the Palestinian-Israeli conflict in multiple. And I highly recommend people read Seja Hindi and Seth Klayman's story about, you know, Palestinian Coloradans who have lost family in the conflict. You know, that went way deeper than I did in my story. So, you know, we've covered it on both sides. But, you know, if you're not getting traction at those two levels, where do you go?
Yeah.
And this is a public forum. It's not like the state legislature has public comment every week.
Right.
City council
There's
does.
Not a lot of places to do this
right.
or have the, you know, have the floor.
It's a platform.
Right.
And,
absolutely.
And you've seen, and, you know, this is, now I am curious, like, does this become sort of a pattern for people? As I said, council comment, people will come with their causes. I heard about this JNF conference months ago, before any of what was going on
because
in Israel
and ongoing,
Gaza was, you know, happening. But you'll see other people just come with like personal grievances, right? Like, I've been in a dispute with such and such agency and I'm here to talk about it.
Which is normally what I feel like I see in the, when you go to the city council public
comment.
It's
the stuff
that's
that
not...
gets lampooned, right? Like,
yeah.
I mean, Parks and Rec had a really classic episode that really nails that like public comment idea. But this is how you, I mean, even if you're talking to a body that may not have a ton of influence on like the broader scale of this conflict, it's a place to make your voice heard. So
before we move on, we're just going to be watching this conference, right? Because it's going on all weekend. Mm-hmm. So, and our governor's going to be there. This should be, I don't know.
I mean, the pro-Palestinian groups have, you know, their goal is to shut down this conference. They've made that plain. DPD has already come out and said, we're going to provide more resources around security. They don't ever, you know, talk about plans, obviously. But yeah, it's going to be, I think Saturday is the biggest event on the schedule for the protest side. It wouldn't be the first time that there's been some, you know, people protested the 2008 DNC in a major way here in the city.
Absolutely.
So yeah, it is going to be interesting.
Well, we're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, more show.
Tis the season to shine with H&M. Discover the holiday collection and find fashionable pieces for your wardrobe or for under the tree. Get inspired and dazzle with this year's glam. From tuxedo styles, bow detailed pieces, impressive prints, and more. From unforgettable looks to unforgettable gifts. With fashion finds to home decor, find it all at H&M. Treat your loved ones and yourself this season. Shop in-store or at hm.com.
And we're back. We're talking about downtown. Commuters still aren't coming back, at least in the amount that they were pre-pandemic. Businesses are suffering. We all know this story. But what's new is Mayor Mike has a plan. Joe, you reported this week on some moves he's made so far this year. We're talking about the web building in particular, but what's Mayor Mike's plan?
His budget says $58 million for downtown revitalization.
Aha.
And what does that mean? You know, that can take many forms. The concrete things I've seen so far, and the first one wasn't even on the 2024 side of the budget year, there was that activations grants, as you probably saw, the $335,000.
Took a hard look at those.
Yeah, so they were, he was, events they're giving out grants to folks who want to organize events and things to do along 16th Street Mall. Like activations.
What,
you've probably seen
events.
This meet in the street. We've done them for many years before that. They set up climbing walls. They set up, you know, beer gardens, all kinds of things. So that was pre this budget.
Yeah. Okay. And that's a small, you know, that's taking a first bite out of it, trying to just generate some buzz. And, you know, you'll see in the numbers, like Saturday is going to be a big day for downtown because it's Parade of Lights. That's always a big spike.
That's right.
Yeah, they were setting up the podiums and the platforms yesterday. Santa Claus is coming to town.
It's a historic day to freeze your butt off as a child.
It's a classic,
Remember, I miserably sat through it so many years as a child, Joe. I'm sure
my
you did,
too. My tears are freezing to my face. but so then, you know, I'm very curious where the rest of that money is going to go. And I have to go in and check on some of these line items. What is that $58 million next year going to look
downtown
like?
Downtown revitalization is a very broad thing.
So this sublease within Republic Plaza, they were already moving the Denver District Attorney's Office there. They were in the Webb building. They're moving. They want their own space. They're going into Republic Plaza already. So
you're talking about city workers.
Yeah.
Mayor Mike has decided that instead of allowing city workers to
work from home
while the Webb building is being renovated, that instead he is going to lease them space in Republic Plaza.
Yep.
One of the emptiest and cheapest and oldest and...
And the tallest in town.
Uh-huh.
Give it its due. It's a big white rectangle, but it is the tallest building in town. but yeah, so they had this existing lease and Mike, Mayor Johnston, had given the director of real estate a directive that said, go out and find some cheap lease space. And it is available, particularly on that end of downtown, what they would call upper downtown.
Updo,
if you will. A central business district for the old heads. and that was available. And so, and you know, there was some talk, like there were also teams that wanted, like, oh, we found that we work better in person. But they did... it was very much an economic development directive from the mayor, as I understand it, from talking to the director of real estate. So, that's another $5 million to sublease this space on a rotating, you know, they're going to rotate city departments based on the phasing of when your floor in the Webb building is under construction. And the idea is to keep them downtown and patronizing the businesses there. And what I thought was an interesting viewpoint was Chris Hines, Councilman Hines, who represents District 10 in downtown. He said city workers could be ambassadors for downtown. And I find that I kind of fill that role at times because I live in Capitol Hill.
Mm-hmm.
For like I hear people be like, well, there's nothing going on down there. It's like, well, I actually, you know, there's things that I like
what's
in
your
that
pitch?
Neighborhood.
What's your
You're
best
like,
pitch
I've
for downtown?
I've actually been there in the last 6 months.
I live around the corner from Benny Blanco's, and like that sells itself.
That's a good one. That's a good pizza place right there.
Some of my favorite pizza, some of my weirdest customer service experiences. Still, it's great pizza.
They gave my dog Monty a slice of pizza for free on his birthday. So.
That rules.
Yeah, we're tight.
Shout out to Benny Blanco's.
But you know, I part of it is that I cover City Hall, and I appreciate the proximity to my coverage area. I don't pay for parking. I walk to meetings. But there, you know, the downtown convenience still resonates with me as a person that lives downtown. But yeah, there is like a perception of, you know, it's, if you listen to certain media sources, like, oh, it's an unsafe place. You can't come down there. And, you know, I talk to business owners that say the same thing. It's like, I'm constantly like battling this public perception. Like the guy that owns West of Surrender, he's like, I can't get the word out enough to people. Like, it's not that bad. Like, yeah, there's homelessness, but that's true across the city in many places. Like,
I think the 16th Street Mall being torn up is also a big thing.
Oh, and that, and what normally, can the mayor do about that? You know, the project's underway.
I was going to say timing wise, it just was bad timing.
He spoke to that on the campaign trail. Like, it's not just, you have DIA and then 16th Street. Like, so visitors arrive and the airport is a mess and then you get off at Union Station and 16th Street Mall is a mess. Like the timing is tough. But I mean, there's federal dollars tied up in all this. Like there's some
it's
things
just
you just,
it's rolling
it
out.
Just, it's tough. Yeah. And when it does start opening, you know, it's going to be different. It's going to be, there's optimism in the way that you know, there's optimism when things are like at their low point, right? Like, yeah. Oh, here's an opportunity.
We can only
to rebuild.
Go up from here.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Well, and so another building sort of at the center of this conversation is the Webb building, which is, I think, maybe 20 years old. It's a new building.
That shocked me when you told me that earlier this week. We talked about this.
Oh, yeah.
We were reading your story, Joe, and I was like, the Webb building? Oh, yeah, it is kind of
old.
It's really old.
I was like, no.
No, 20 years old. It just feels old. It feels like cramped in some places, like stuffy in some places.
And they're saying they're remodeling it, which I know you said, you just said it's stuffy and cramped. You know, like you've been in that building a lot. I was surprised that these improvements that they're making to the building are like basically just trying to bring it up to code for ADA. And like
the Department of Justice sent the city a letter a couple of years ago being like, your public spaces do not meet current code.
And like
a list of recommendations.
The ADA was passed in 1990. This building was built much long after that. It's wild to me. But Paul, the cramped and stuffiness, you're saying this probably does need to be done to get people to be in that building.
I bet the city's having the same problem that every other company with office has offices downtown is having. They're probably struggling to convince people it's a good to come back to the office. That's what this Republic Plaza lease is so interesting to me. Like, I get how there maybe are some teams with some like maybe older people on it that like coming in so much that they'll go to a old shabby office. But I mean, the young people on those teams, that sounds like that's going to be a struggle coming up for the city. That's talented young people that I would like to be working for the city.
Yeah, no, I agree with that.
I do wonder about, you know, the city is understaffed in so many departments and has been for a long time, right? Like hiring and retention, I'll be paying attention to that. Yeah. Is it tough? I think Republic Plaza, I'd have to go back. I did cover commercial real estate for 4 years before this. So, I mean, there was, even before COVID, there was what they called the flight to quality. The buildings on the east side of downtown are older.
Uh-huh.
They were built during like the oil boom, right? Like these buildings are like, the birth of the Denver skyline, right? And then what's down at Lodo, that's what's new and hip. And those are the Instagrammable spaces.
Oh my God. Did you see that New York Times story?
Thank you to Paul.
Can Instagrammable design lure young workers back?
Well, if you go to Rhino, you see those places, right? You go to Zeppelin Station. Mm-hmm. It's like a hip workspace. That's not the case, but there has been, you know, a lot of those building owners, the people that bought those older properties or have owned them for a long time, they've tried to invest, and there was some redevelopment of some of those spaces. I think Troy Gard is opening a wine bar in the basement of Republic Plaza or in that food court. So there will be stuff, right?
Mm, that's something.
But, it's like web building. Like at a certain point, your building needs a refresh, or it's just going to, it gets what they call, you know, it gets downgraded. There's like class A space, then there's class B, and then there's class C. And that dictates like what you can charge in rent, all kinds of things.
If you're going to attract people in a market that's already tough to attract selling office space in the first place.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know. The thing to me is like, I found it mildly offensive that the New York Times was like implying that young people just want a place to take a picture. Like, they're more complex than that. I know there's a lot of assumptions about people that take selfies, but working from home is, if you have a disability, it's a thing that folks with disabilities have been asking for decades. If you have kids, if you're a caregiver, if you have a schedule that is so much easier when you're at home, that Instagrammable workspace isn't going to fix any of those problems. So I'm struggling to see how this will work.
A lot of the like nicest buildings I would go tour when I was covering real estate, they were in like really hyper competitive fields. Like BP has an office, the oil and gas company, on in Lohi, and talk about baller. Like they have a Tulum room with like a hanging swing.
Yeah.
But those are like hyper competitive. I mean, you're competing
that's not
with
city
other
workers,
as oil and gas engineers, and it was before COVID. Before we realized, hey, we can do a lot of this stuff.
And the city's not going to be doing that for a lot of reasons. Like, also, it wouldn't look good if the city was like, oh, we're building a Tulum room in this office. Like, no, just hire more people to work at the DMV, please, or whatever.
Yeah.
So
you wonder what the city's pitch is compared to private business, right? Like, you know, there's always the talk of like a public pension and that.
Totally.
There's a call to service, like I want to do something on the public service side. So it's a different set of offerings, right? Like it's a different value That's offer compared to other businesses, private industry, I think. And to, you know, Mike Johnson wasn't the first mayor to say, like, you must come downtown. Like right, Hancock right. said that, right? You know, the hybrid model where you work downtown 3 days a week, that started under Hancock. Because these city leaders do, you know, they, especially in when so much of our tax base is sales tax, like they understand like what happens if you have, you know, a downtown business core that's not thriving.
Yeah. And some understand it better than others. I mean, maybe it's, well, I don't know. I mean, I talked to our colleagues at CityCast Houston about this and like the work from home conundrum. And they were just like, no, our mayor was like, go back to work. And then our city did. And now our downtown's okay.
Interesting.
Yeah. So it was like those decisions that at the time seemed like these life and death decisions. Now we have the consequences we're living with now.
And like, our mayor's not in charge of private businesses, so he's doing what he thinks he can, which is like, okay, let's try to rent some space and bring some people downtown.
Lead this by is example, what I can do. Inspiration.
Yeah.
Hopefully.
I mean, it'll be interesting. We have a hybrid situation and it works really well for us, but
I'm counting down the days till that coffee shop downstairs opens.
I am
I'll tell
too,
you that.
Honestly.
That renovation project in the lobby, it's getting close and like
I cannot wait.
Queen City Co-op, we're ready for you.
I can't wait. Because I don't make coffee at home. Let's be serious. Okay. Well, we're gonna take another quick break, and when we come back, our mile highs and lows of the week. We're back. We're talking about the best things and the worst things that happened this week here with our Rocky Mountain highs and lows. Excuse me. We're going to start with fails because we always like to end on a good note. Paul, what sucked for you this week?
Well, I got my fail. It's like kind of a follow up to our conversation earlier this week about President Biden's visit. We mentioned to him and the hotel he was staying at. So when we talked about this on Tuesday, Bree, we made two predictions about what we might talk about. We said, since he's going to Pueblo, he might talk about Boebert, and perhaps he might give a little presidential push to the Mike Johnston House 1000 effort, which right. we know he supports right. because they've added Denver to this national
all
program.
Inside, yeah.
All inside, that's what it's called.
Yes, exactly. So the Colorado Sun reports that at the campaign fundraiser stop in Cherry Hills Village that President Biden attended, this was his only Denver stop apparently, he did not mention Mike Johnston and homelessness. He did, however, call out Congresswoman Lauren Boebert by name. He said, folks, this is not your father's Republican Party. So that's my fail because like—
What does that even mean?
Who knows?
This is not your great-grandpa's Republican Party.
he's talking about MAGA, I think. He's talking about like the tone and the rhetoric. That's what I would guess.
Okay. I think I'm just— Again, I have to be a Boebert defender for a minute. I just am extra sensitive. I'm just extra sensitive about her being slut-shamed. That was my frustrating part.
Oh,
and I don't think that's what he's implying. But.
Maybe.
But so your fail is that
he missed this opportunity to support this promising, energizing project that needs support more than ever. It needs people to just be like inspired to participate. And instead he used the whatever platform this was for an attack on Lauren Boebert.
Thumbs down for Joe Biden.
Thumbs down for President Biden.
Joe, what's your fail?
It's personal. And Bree, you've probably... We have these conversations a lot on social media. El Tepehuan is going under, and they had been closed for a while, and like they were in between spaces, and I never thought they'd come back. And when they came back, I was very excited. But yeah, El Tepehuan was the first place. It's a Mexican restaurant in Inglewood, South Broadway. It's the first place I ever had green chili, and even beyond that, it's the first place my parents ever had green chili when they first moved out here in the late 70s. When they were from New Jersey, and they didn't know what it was.
Joke.
Yeah, exactly. I know. And you can go down the list of all these places. Breakfast King really hurt me too because I'm from Southwest Denver and that was my spot. But yeah, El Tepehuan, it sounds like it's, you know, the owner retiring. It's not one of those like landlord raise the rent
yeah,
and they had to relocate. Yeah.
45 years.
And you hear those stories a lot. Like it's tough. And, you know, you can't, you know, sometimes next generation family doesn't want to take the business, whatever it is. But it is, I'm hoping to get in there. I'm hoping they have nice long lines, but I'm going to go get on the list because I will miss them consistently. I like that they never seem to dumb down. Like the salsa was hot, the chili was hot. It never, like, they're like, we're not trying to like
appease.
Water this down. Yeah, this is what it tastes like.
Appease
and I
these
love that.
Bland yeah. palates.
Even if it burned me up.
Do you have a favorite dish or plate or what you get combo you get at El Topo One?
I would just go like the carne asada burrito there was really excellent. And they would chop up some like jalapenos and tomatoes and onions in the meat. And I mean, a really hot burrito, but really excellent. Or just breakfast smothered. And they do the like cheese, the cheddar and not melt it under the burner. You know, they put it on cold and let it kind of melt
love
itself.
It. Love it.
Excellent.
Oh, I might have to try to do a stop there too. Oh, rest in peace, El Topo One.
Bree, how about you? What's your fail?
Mine's a huge bummer, as usual. My son's teacher lost her husband to gun violence this week, and she has 4 children and 1 on the way. And I just can't imagine going through that. And gun violence always feels like preventable in some way. Like it didn't have to happen, you know? And I don't know the specifics of it. I have a GoFundMe for her that was shared with me that I can share with folks if they're interested. Surviving that and raising a family, I'm just sad for her. And it just makes me think about all of these conversations we just continually have about gun violence and what can be done and what can be done. And just remember the real causes or the real impacts of it every day happen every day. And I think we've talked to Representative Tom Sullivan. I feel like mm-hmm. he talked about like mass shootings get the news, but it's every day this is happening. So it's just a reminder that it's something that impacts people every day. So, okay, well, let's move to some happy stuff. Joe, do you want to share your win?
Well, this is just from my perspective as because House 1000 is, you know, such a dominant topic right now. This is a low key win, I think, for Mayor Johnston. He hired a director for Host, Jamie Reif. She was just named this week. She was the Metro Denver Homeless Initiative, which was the HUD, the federal government designated agency that gathers data on homelessness. So they run the point in time count every year. And the reason I'd count it as a win is even Lisa Calderon, who produced a grade for the mayor yesterday that was not good. She graded him a D thus far in his administration, which he has disputed. She was also like, this is a good hire. And, you know, Jamie Reif knows homelessness on a regional level and has a ton of experience. So if you're getting even your, you know, critics on, you know, from the left side to support your hire for a critical, I mean, Host is going to be huge for Mayor Johnston's goals, right? It's not just the homelessness, but housing. Yeah.
Stability.
The Department of Housing Stability. And you probably remember
I know.
Well,
people in
over the years under, you know, this agency really emerged under Hancock. There were multiple iterations and things, false starts, things that didn't work.
Yeah, it was like
right?
the first guy Host, they brought in to run it ditched out in a couple weeks. So
Host is critical, right? They're not a charter agency, but they are a huge part of his administration. So hiring somebody who's at, you know, at the earliest stages, getting some, you know, people are optimistic, that's a big win.
Well, and someone that's worked like on homelessness on a regional level is really great for us because then they probably know folks in other municipalities surrounding us. And a lot of times we work in these sort of silos, and that would be coordinated effort. That would be incredible. That could be a big change for us.
Yeah, you hear from people that are, you know, they get frustrated because it's like homelessness is not a Denver problem.
No.
It's a regional and national problem.
Yeah. So that's good. Paul?
All right. My win this week is sort of a lifetime achievement win. And I'm giving it to Dr. Martin Lockley, who is the co-founder of the nonprofit Friends of Dinosaur Ridge. He sadly passed away this week at the age of 73 after a fight with cancer this year. The press person at Dinosaur Ridge sent a press release earlier this week saying this stuff. And he was a world-renowned paleontologist. And just quoting from this press release, Dr. Lockley taught at UC Denver for 30 years and was a professor emeritus. He is the paleontologist who put Dinosaur Ridge on the map, literally renaming that section of the Hogback, which sits in Jefferson County open space. I didn't know this. His particular expertise was identifying dinosaur tracks. I guess he was very well known for this. And Dinosaur Ridge, of course, famously has, you know, pretty well-preserved dinosaur tracks. So.
Oh, that's so cool.
They're renaming some discovery center after him now out at Dinosaur Ridge. I think there's going to be a ceremony. I'll put links in the show notes. But lifetime achievement win to Dr. Martin Lockley.
It's such a great reminder, too, that big things that become institutions in our city, in our state, start with somebody's passion.
Yeah.
Like this guy really cared and was really interested and he made his mark here, but it ended up being this incredible. I mean, we've talked to, who was that lovely person I talked to at Dinosaur Ridge? Like people that are into dinosaurs, they are seriously into dinosaurs. And yeah. I love that about them. Like she was so passionate to talk about the Stegosaurus, but someone like this is like creating those spaces for us to learn and that become an integral part of who we are. It's so cool.
Truly. Yeah.
Several childhood field trips. Thank you very
totally.
Much, Mr. Lockley. Yeah,
that's
absolutely.
So sweet.
It's still cool. Now I want to go back up there and check
it
out.
Me too. I've been thinking about it all week.
No, I'm going to bring Montgomery up there. That sounds great.
All right, Bree, what's your win?
You know, there was a great story in Westward this week about the high dive being open for 20 years. 20 years.
I did not wear my high dive 20th anniversary sweatshirt, but I thought about it.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Wait, you got.
I love their Yelp shirts that say shit people.
Oh, I never bought one, but I did love it. Yeah.
They were like, yeah, that Yelp review is accurate. Sure. Shit bar shit people. No, but I'm a million years old. I was there the opening night of the high dive. It was the Yeah's after party. I think they played at the Gothic and then they DJ'd. Nick and Karen came and DJ'd.
Cool.
It was sick. And then I went to an after party where they also were there. And I felt like, oh my God, Denver's the coolest place in the world. Here in 2003, I'm hanging out with the Yeah's in a house party. But
High Dive is still cool.
Its evolution has been beautiful, honestly. So Allison and Matt that opened it, super cool people. I especially want to say thank you to Matt LaBarge because one time they also owned Sputnik, the adjoining restaurant and bar, the couple that opened it originally. It's different ownership now, but I got kicked out of Sputnik for some drinking things I was doing, but I had to play later that night at the High Dive and Matt LaBarge let me back in. So shout out to him.
That's nice of Matt.
But I just have so many fond memories of that place. It's where my first band, The Hot House, played a lot. We used to play with our friends of Photo Atlas. Photo Atlas filmed a bunch of, they did a couple, I can't find them online. Hmm. They did two music videos in the basement of the High Dive that I remember being in.
And what's
it was
the basement
so
like?
Fun.
Is it gnarly down there?
It was. I don't know. They've done a lot of work in there, so it might be nice, but it was dank.
Yeah.
It's a bunker.
But the best part is people, someone started this trend of writing band names as food in the basement.
Yes.
Do you remember this, Joe?
Yes.
So the walls are just covered with like.
I'm trying to think of some good winners. There's some great ones.
I can't think of a good one. Oh my God.
I'm just a hanger on, but I've known enough local bands that I've been invited downstairs once or twice. And yeah, I'm glad you remember that because that was funny.
And the nastiest couches that.
Oh yeah.
Maybe shouldn't have been sitting on. But now it's run by some other really wonderful folks, Maddie Clark, I think Marika Emerson, his wife. And I mean, there's tons of, I just know so many people that have come in and out of there. And they've just always supported local music as well as bringing national acts in. And it's just such a cool staple. And I'm really proud that something is now Old Denver.
Old Denver, yeah.
It's 20 years old.
I mean, it is sceney, but it doesn't feel sceney, right? It feels so like open to all. And I've seen so much different music there and so like just so many great shows.
I mean, anybody that knows Nathaniel Rateliff will know that was his spot. That's where he really hung out and started and played. Yeah. And so it's just produced a lot of cool people and they still do amazing stuff. And if you haven't been to the High Dive, I highly recommend it. Go see a show there. My favorite time is during UMS when it's just packed and sweaty. But shout out to them, 20 years. Great
Cheers,
job, you guys.
Absolutely.
That's impressive.
Yeah.
Impressive.
So, okay. Well, that's it. Joe, thanks for coming and joining us.
My pleasure.
Paul, as always.
Yeah, thanks Bree.
Thanks, Bree.
That's all for today here on CityCast Denver. Our producers this week were Paul Caroli and Olivia Jewel Love. Peyton Garcia writes our morning newsletter, Hey Denver. I'm Bree Davies, your host. Our music is by Los Mocachetes, with additional mixing by Tyler Lindgren. The Christmassy mix of one of our usual interstitials was mixed by Denver local and listener Jacob Bloom. If you haven't already, subscribe wherever you get your podcasts, follow us on Instagram at CityCast Denver, and tell Sean Rundle we said hey. You can sign up for our daily newsletter and learn more about us at denver.citycast.fm.